we shall take another example. This is about 15:1 duplicate gene, wherein I have given the example of rice plant. Okay. So 15:1 duplicate gene, I have given the example of the crop rice, and what we have taken is the rice, okay, the own of the rice. So here I have put the parent genotype. If it is a capital A and capital B, it is owned. If it is a small a and small b, it is ownless. Okay, own means like, see, if this is your paddy, okay, one seed of the paddy, you will see that some will have this hairy like structure here. Okay, this is called as own. In some, this is not there. Okay, so if this is a paddy, you have, this is all the rice inside. This you have, this is the outer husk, and inside this you will be having the rice or the paddy, and outside here it will be having this terminal region, no, it will be having that hairy like. Okay, in some rice plant that is there, in some it is not there. So that one is the example we have taken here. So owned and ownless. This is the parent, and in F1, as you always know, that is, it will be the dominant one which shows up in the phenotype. So we have got the dominant out, and it is always heterozygous. F1 is dominant heterozygous. So then we, what we do, we'll do a self crossing, and then we'll draw this Punnett square or the checker box. And we have drawn all the gametes, the male and the female gametes we have drawn. Now this is a very simple example. So what is our criteria, or what is our definition of this duplicate gene is, I should have a capital A or a capital B, okay, or I should have one, now here it is a heterozygous, I should have one, at least a capital A, or I should have one capital B. Okay, so here, see, I have only capital A, but here it is small b. Okay, I'll change the color. Okay, so this is small b, but this is a capital A. So another example, for instance, where we can show both the capital. See here, this is See here, both these are capital B, but it's having small a. But still, it is having one capital B, right? Here, at least here also, it is having one capital A, one capital B. Here you can see one capital A and one capital B. So under these condition, okay, if at least either one A or one B is present, that is the duplicate gene is present, then that all the phenotype will be owned. Okay, that is, they'll be having this hairy like structure. Okay, that is called owned. So how many you can see? It is 15. But here you can see both are recessive. Okay, there is no capital A, there is no capital B. So they'll be ownless. Okay, they'll be ownless. That's it about this. Okay. So I've just drawn it in a pictorial form here. You can see either I should have a gene A or a gene B to give this colored kernel. Okay, of this, that is this. So with that, we complete our epistaxis. So you studied about dominant, recessive, okay, that is the supplementary, complementary, you have studied, 13:3 ratio we studied, 15:1 epistasis, all this comes under the epistasis chapter. There are few more examples, but usually that does not come in the examination, but if time prevails we will see to that also, the other examples also. But for now you have to remember this all, because this is very clearly mentioned in your syllabus. Now coming to karyotyping. Now what picture you are seeing, okay, this is called as a karyotyping, and you all must have guessed this is the human chromosome. Okay, we have the 23 pairs of human chromosome. So this karyotyping is pairing or ordering of all the chromosomes of an organism. It need not be only the human chromosome, even a rat or a mouse or monkey's chromosome also, the scientists do the same type of karyotyping, maybe for to study their genes or their chromosomes. Okay, here karyotyping is pairing or ordering all the chromosome of an organism. In other simple way we can tell that it is a snapshot of individual's chromosomes. Okay, so if this is a person, okay, this is a person, so what the professional geneticists do is, if they want to study this person's history of his chromosome, how it is, okay, whether all the chromosomes are fine or is it any defect is there in his chromosome, then they'll do such type of karyotyping. So this snapshot is called as a karyotyping. And if you see this chromosomes, you see that all the chromosomes are not same, okay, they are different in their size and shape. So karyotyping is a test to examine the chromosomes and identify the genetic problem. So a normal people, this is what chart I have put, it is a of a normal individual. But any variation from this, if this person is suffering from some disease and then there is any variation in his chromosome, then the doctor can come or the medical professional can come to know that what is the genetic order this person is suffering from. For example, see, if and there is an extra chromosome here, okay, so instead of 2 I'm having an extra chromosome, so it becomes what, trisomy. It is a condition which should not happen, or it is going to lead to a genetic defect. Okay, so that time what happens when they do such type of karyotyping, they'll come to know where exactly the defect is. Maybe this part of the chromosome itself is not there in this patient, so the doctor will come to know, okay, every other chromosome is fine, only the chromosome 15 is showing some defect. So what are the genes which are present in chromosome 15? Earlier time it was very difficult to find out, but now, and since in my first class I told you, because of the human genome, okay, we have got the entire picture of all this 46 chromosome, what genes they are carrying, okay, this entire catalog is present, this record is present, okay. So now it becomes very easy, like what are the genes in that chromosome 15 and what genes are being missing in that chromosome, so what type of diseases it is leading to. So remember this part, because throughout our next chapters we will always be speaking about the chromosomes and their deficiency and all. So we have this 22, okay girls, from 1 to 22 are called as autosomes. These are called as autosomes, autosomes. And then the last you see, okay, what is called as sex chromosome, or it is called as allosomes. Actually here in this chart it represents both male and female, but in actual if it is a female this Y will not be, okay, if it is a male 1X will not be, okay. Just this is just for representation, I have chosen this chart which is carrying both the female and male, but remember If it is a male, only you will be having this part. If it is a female, it is only this region. Okay. So we have the autosome and allosome. So remember these terms, because again, when we go, as I told you, as we go further, we cannot keep repeating these. Now let us see what is the difference between these autosomes and allosomes. So autosomes, it is not a sex chromosome. Other than your X and Y, whatever chromosome, the 22 pairs you saw, that is your autosome. These determine the somatic traits. Okay, other than sex, they determine the other traits. Then what are allosomes? These determine the sex of an organism. What is the gender of the this organism is? Okay, so the actually the gender we don't use. We say the what is the sex? Okay, whether it is a male or the female. So these are labeled with numbers 1 to 22. Here it is labeled as X and X for female, X and Y for male, or if there is some in some animals, okay, or some insects, there are different type of naming it, like X, O, Z, W, so on. There are same copies of autosomes in male and female. Allosomes, difference in size, behavior and form in males and females. So we have all the 22 chromosomes same, but only the sex chromosomes are different in size. So we will see in the next chart what about the size of X and Y. Most of the chromosomes in the genomes are autosomes, whereas only a few chromosomes are allosomes. Of course, that is true. We have seen in the karyotype chart. Most of them are autosomes. Only few are the sex chromosome or the allosomes. So autosome shows Mendelian inheritance, whereas allosomes do not show the Mendelian inheritance. This we will be studying with the examples, okay. From most of the now whatever classes, we will be dealing with this part, okay, allosomes. The pair of autosomes are homologous in human, but whereas the allosome, female allosome are homologous, while the male allosomes are non-homologous. That's what we told, okay. See, I have X and X, which is homologous, okay, whereas X and Y, it is not homologous, okay. Till now what you have read, it will be heterozygous. Now we'll use another word for male chromosome. It is called as hemizygous. In the next slide you can see that the number of genes vary from 200 to 2000 in autosomes. In allosomes, you see Y chromosomes contain a few genes, but X chromosomes contain more than 300 genes, okay. So just remember, like almost I told you that there are 20 to 25,000 genes which are present, and look at the enormous amount of time taken by the different scientists who were involved in the human genome project, okay. And I also told you that with the advent of this bioinformatics, when they started integrating computer science with biology, I told you that it went on very super fast, okay. What time they had allowed it to finish, we had finished before that itself. So this is about the our allosome. You can see this is the X chromosome and this is the Y chromosome. Now we saw that we spoke about the size. You see that the X chromosome is quite little bit bigger than the Y chromosome, okay. The Y chromosome is missing this section of X chromosome, so this part is not there, okay. It is not there in the X chromosome. The lower sections of both the chromosome contain the genes for the same trait, okay. So they are similar here. So the Y chromosome is much shorter than the X chromosome and contains only few genes, as we spoke about in the previous slide. Okay, they contain few of the genes. The X chromosome is longer and contains many genes not present on the Y chromosomes. Look at this, this is quite longer than the Y, and it contains more genes which are missing here. Okay, which is missing here. Hence, sex linked condition are usually X linked, as very few genes exist on the shorter Y chromosome. So, whenever we use sex linked, immediately what should come to your mind is we are talking about the X chromosome. Okay, a sex linked condition, if a person, this we'll put our human, where is that human drawing, we'll put, this fellow. Now the doctors have done the karyotyping and they come to know that he is having some problem, in his what, allosome. So you'll see that he is a colorblind fellow or he is having hemophilia. So immediately what happens, they'll come to know that the genes which are for the color blindness or for the hemophilia, it is present on the X chromosome. Then they'll tell that he is having a disorder in the sex linked. So any other genetics or any other genetic professional, he'll come to know that sex linked means, this doctor is talking about something about the sex X chromosome. Hope it is very clear. If you can just go through it. I'll just go to the next slide. Hope it's done with. So, for time being, just concentrate only about the X. Do not worry about this all. I'll deal it with separately. So you can see that most of the diseases like color blindness, hemophilia, or SCID, whatever you name them, it is all associated with the X chromosomes. And you can see this beautiful pic here. This is an electron microscopy image of your X and Y chromosome. See how we have drawn and how actually it appears. They are so beautiful in appearance. So, if the two X chromosome is X and X, they are present in the embryo, it develops into female. If it is X and Y, they develop into male. This one you are all familiar with. So let us see in the pictorial diagram what we told here, X and X female, X and Y male. So if this is the mother, X and X is a female, so if she marries X and Y, which is represents the male chromosome, now they become the mother and father, they will be having a child. Suppose say this child is female, so it will be having X and X. Suppose their child is a male, then they'll be having X and Y. You can see why it is so. So you see the red arrow markers. So this is X. One X is gone into this embryo female, and always remember the X of the male, the X chromosome of the male will always go to the female, to his daughter. There is no change in this, this is universal. So always the X chromosome of the father will go to the daughter, and the Y chromosome he will give it to his son. just capture this picture in your mind. This is how the pattern is. So there'll be, if it is a male child, if they're having, this is it, and female means this is it. Now another important girls. This is also universal. Okay, crisscross. This question they'll ask, what is the crisscross? Crisscross means, now what did I tell? The father's X chromosome will come to this daughter only. This is universal phenomena. Okay, very good. We'll go to the next one. What is crisscross? Crisscross is, now suppose you consider this girl, this female child is grown up now, okay, and she has got married. This girl, okay, this girl in the next chart, this female, the daughter, okay. Okay, she has married and now she has become a mother. Now, from where did she get her X chromosome? One, she got it from the mother, and another, she has got it from her father. That is what I have marked it in red. Okay, this is what chromosome she got it from her father. Now, this girl has married. So, now what happens? Don't be bothered of this daughter and all now. Just see the pattern. Always this girl will donate her X chromosome. From where did she get this red X chromosome? She got it from her father, right? She will always donate that to her. She will always donate this to her son. Okay, always to the son. This is universal. Okay, so in other words, I can tell that this son is carrying the X chromosome which was given by his mother. In turn, you can tell that this X chromosome is come from the grandfather, right? Now this father will become this child's grandfather, right? Okay, so this is called as a crisscross pattern. Okay, the X chromosome which the mother has obtained from the father, okay, it will go to the son. So the son is who? The son is now the grandson of this girl's father. Okay, that's what I have mentioned. So just remember this two phenomena. Okay, this is the pattern how they go through. So we'll speak about the sex linkage. Genes that are sex linked are on the X chromosome. Obviously now you know about this. Okay, I told you, like, when sex linked means immediately the picture in your mind should come is the X chromosomes. Genes on the Y are not sex linked. Okay, they are called holandric. So for time being, we'll stick on only to the X chromosome. Y chromosome, what is the importance of Y chromosomes and what it can lead to, we will speak in a separate chapter. Because the males have only one X chromosome, any gene on the X in the male is expressed. Okay, whether it is dominant or recessive. Now why this is happening is, we have X and Y. Okay, in female we have X and X. Remember, X is the dominant gene. The females will be having two X, two dominant genes. But you see in male, only one X. Okay, sorry. Only one X, and that is the dominant. This has nothing role. So in contrast, females have two X, so recessive traits are often covered by the dominant normal allele. In most cases, genetic diseases are recessive. Okay. Why? In most cases, genetic diseases are recessive. See here, for example, if this X is dominant and this is recessive, if there is a disease, okay, always your dominant will help you to mask the recessive. Unfortunately, here in male, that cannot happen. If he is carrying a gene, okay, which is corrupt, there is no another X chromosome to help him to come out of the diseases. See here, these are the all diseases which are associated with the X chromosome. Okay, so if one of my X chromosome is carrying that disease and the other is fine, very well, I will not get the disease. Maybe that female will be a carrier, but she will not get the disease. When she will get the disease, that is also we will see. Okay, we will take that example also and see. Thus, most sex-linked genetic diseases are much more common in males than in females. Okay, because of this condition. Okay, because of the second point, you can see that most of the sex-linked genetic diseases are much more common in male than in females. So, having only one copy of the gene is called as hemizygous. Okay, so I told you that it is not called as heterozygous, but here it is called as hemizygous. Sex-linked genes in male mammals are hemizygous. That is, it is not possible for these genes to be either homozygous or heterozygous. They cannot be so, because I mean the nature has created them like that. They should have one X and one Y. Since those conditions imply having two copies of gene. I'll just stop here and continue with the another video.